Today we're talking about the trade war with China, because Chinese-made products have just continued to get more and more expensive. I was trying to buy a finger trap the other day and it cost a whole 10,000 tickets. So this thing's been going on for a while, and it's gone from terrifying to mundane faster than North Korean negotiations. Yeah, remember when we thought the Trump meeting with Kim Jong-un could lead to nuclear war? Instead of what they turned out to be, the geopolitical equivalent of seeing that typing ellipsis and waiting for the message to finally come in. Last week, we had a meeting with the Chinese to negotiate an end to the war, although it might have been doomed from the start, because during that negotiation, an additional $16 billion in tariffs were imposed by Washington, making this whole thing kind of feel like saying you're not going to cheat again as you continue to simultaneously swipe right on every profile on Tinder.
After 2 days of trade talks in Washington, China and the U.S. are walking away with very little. On Thursday, the White House said they talked about, quote, structural issues in China, but didn't give signs of any major breakthroughs.
Structural problems? I thought this was about the trade deficit. Turns out, unsurprisingly, the US position is a little more complicated than buy more of our stuff. Today I'm going to try to answer the question, why can't we just be friends? Well, a recent Bloomberg article listed 5 obstacles that we're going to need to iron out in the coming negotiations. Boy, that is one of those lists that looks so boring it must be important. So let's just work our way from the top down with technology transfers. So this revolves around mandatory joint ventures for companies that want to do business in China. And let me break that down a little. Basically, Americans are mad because in our opinion, Chinese companies are essentially acting like the lazy kid in a group project. You do all the work, but because the teacher slapped the two of you together, well, he gets as much claim to the final product as you do.
When you try and do business in China as an American company, it's nearly impossible unless you have a Chinese partner right. That has access to your R&D and your intellectual property, and see how many businesses are still in business in China that have gone that route.
So yeah, if you want to do business in China, you have to take on a Chinese partner who has access to your research and development as well as your intellectual property. Well, that clearly seems not great for America, or legal. So it's not as simple as you either partner with us or you can't sell in China. Although, it is pretty simple. Using research from the auto industry, we see that many top brands like GM, Volkswagen, and Toyota have teamed up with local players rather than face steep tariffs on imported vehicles. Not everyone's been so lucky. Specifically, the business world's punching bag, Elon Musk. He's currently trying to sell electric cars in China without a local partner. Because, well, if you're going to sell a car for hundreds of thousands of dollars, there better be some special IPs. He wants to manufacture cars in China's Shanghai Special Economic Zone and sell them in mainland China. Sounds simple enough. Unfortunately for him, figuring out how to sell foreign products in China might actually be harder than rocket science. Cars in the Chinese free trade zone still wouldn't escape the country's steep 25% import tariff, because the plant would be in a free trade zone. You can circumvent that by partnering locally, but he doesn't want to, leading to...
A tweet just came in from Elon Musk. He said, for example, an American car going to China pays 25% import duty, but a Chinese car coming to the United States only pays 2.5%, a tenfold difference.
Yep, he just got on Twitter and tweeted the president. Because if you want to know about the intricacies of US policies, ask your teenage daughter. Man, I remember a time when I actually wanted transparency in government. So this is weird, because while every part of this structure makes sense, forcing IP transfers and partnerships, how has China been able to do this for so long from a legal perspective? This is where a major problem comes in, because yeah, this is super illegal in America. The former Chinese Commerce Minister He Weiwan says China thinks that the bilateral trade relation is governed by WTO rules, not American domestic law. Oh no, was America just hoisted by her own petard? According to Li Yang, the deputy director of the Chinese Association of International Trade Expert Community, and for those of you only half paying attention, the China Association of International Trade probably has a little bit of a pro-China agenda, so here's your grain of salt. He says that the U.S. accused China of setting requirements for foreign companies to start joint ventures and cooperate with Chinese firms in certain areas. But the fact was that China, as a WTO member, had the right to relax or limit market access. To resolve this issue, we have seen
Lighthizer will launch a so-called Section 301 investigation under the 1974 Trade Act. This allows the president to unilaterally impose tariffs or other trade restrictions to protect U.S. industries from unfair trade practices of foreign countries.
And on the other side, the Chinese authorities said that in the next 5 years, they would ease rules that have long required car makers to link up with local partners before building a factory in China. See, that's the problem with a country like China, though. You can't set a 5-year timeline for legislation without seeming disingenuous. Now, you could totally say that in America. Oh, we'll introduce this to the House and the Senate. They'll debate it, someone will say something racist, and then we'll debate that for a little while. Then 2 years and 500 meaningless amendments later, we'll pass it. Whereas, come on, President Xi, you might not even need to snap your fingers to get that resolved. So far, no official agreements have come out on this front. So next, we're talking about the problem of industrial overcapacity. This is a weird problem because it is so closely tied to just rampant government inefficiencies in China. And while that might sound like it would be a good thing for the US trade, it's hard to imagine complaining. No fair, he's doing a terrible job managing his economy. That's exactly what's happening in this case. Unlike in America, where demand and supply are linked, for the longest time in China, the government controls supply. And when a ton of money is coming in, well, screw it, let's make a ton of stuff. People like stuff.
1.8 million Chinese coal and steel workers are to be laid off as Beijing tries to reduce overcapacity. That's about 15% of the total workforce in those industries, with those people being reallocated.
Workers being reallocated. Yup, that's a communist country. So China's sitting on a massive amount of steel and coal because, well, they could build it. So they did, and nobody there wants it. So what do you do when you have all this steel just rusting in your warehouse? Well, you have a fire sale. We've got 90% off steel, 90% off coal, and 90% off your local steel industry.
The Salzgitter steel plant in Lower Saxony is operating at full capacity. But despite order books full to bursting, the company barely makes a profit, and it's been that way for years. Salzgitter executives think China bears a large part of the blame for dumping its excess steel production at rock-bottom prices in Europe.
Alright, so what's going on here? Well,
the American steel aluminum industry has been ravaged by aggressive foreign trade practices.
The tariffs, 25% on steel and 10% on aluminum, will be imposed on all imported steel, except from Canada and Mexico, which are exempt, but only for now.
On the other side, President Xi has promised to reform his supply-side structural reform program. But he's doing it really slowly because, to be frank, he prefers American job loss to his own. So Chinese workers will continue to produce unnecessary amounts of materials for the foreseeable future. Because communism is just the best form of government around. So to the next item on the list, SOE reform. So SOE stands for state-owned enterprises, and the Chinese government owns all of the major banks and 40% of the country's industrial assets, and Donald Trump does not like that. This is a weird one because it seems like a who-can-care situation. Oh no, the Chinese government owns a lot of their companies? Well, good thing I'm not in China. But it does have a notable impact on trade. Let's just put it this way. If you have such a strong control over the economy, and you own most of the companies in that economy, you would have to be astoundingly incompetent to make things a level playing field. Despite the fact that this all might start to sound somewhat similar, this criticism is different, because it's based on, to quote the former director general of the World Trade Organization and man who looks evil in every photo I could find of him, China has done a great job of opening its economy in some areas, but in some cases, SOEs have benefited from the privilege of a very low cost of capital.
The perception, which I think is your question, is that SOEs are competing unfairly against Western corporations, against U.S. firms. I'm not sure you can accuse them of being unfair if they're a little inefficient. It is clear that SOEs have preferential access to credit.
Yeah, state-owned enterprises have better access to credit, because that's like moving money from my savings account to my checking account. This leads to inefficiencies that he mentioned, because similar to the criticism about overproduction above, these state-owned enterprises are getting money from the government, and don't really have to make money from the markets, as long as they can keep 5 stars on Yelp and fly under the radar. Basically, it's like a trust fund billionaire who can do pretty much whatever the heck he wants to and still be well off, wondering why poor people don't just work hard like he did. Now, the American government is currently calling for privatization so that we are competing against firms that actually need to turn a profit. But China has responded by consolidating state-owned enterprises into monopolies in their markets. Because screw you guys, we'll do what we want domestically. Or, as Lu Xian, an expert on U.S.-China relations at the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, politely pointed out, without state-owned enterprises, China could no longer call itself a socialist system. Wait, I thought all you needed to go full socialist was a non-exploitative healthcare system. Alright, next on the list, we have industrial policies. Now, this is mainly America being mad about.
It's also clear that they're hell-bent for leather in pursuing their China 2025 plan, where China will focus on technologies of the future to enhance their economy.
Everything we've talked about so far has seemed like a pretty reasonable complaint. But despite the Trump administration's legitimate concerns with it, this criticism falls pretty firmly in the yeah and category. So China's putting a ton of money into subsidizing research into developing new technologies. It's on this list because our Commerce Secretary says things like China 2025 is scary, and they've been the factory floor of the world, now their vision is to be the technology center for the world. So rather than try and match their innovation funding, I think our goal is to just kind of try and get in their way as much as possible. Alright, last on the list, cloud computing, which, yep, we're back at the big boy table again on this one. You know how China is not the biggest fan of, well, 90% of the results that show up when you Google China? Well, they've now got a solution beyond the don't read the comments section.
What concerns critics are the broad powers the law will give China as it pursues so-called cyber sovereignty, that is, control of the internet within its borders. Companies in key industries will need to open up their computer systems for security examinations. Most of their data will need to be stored locally, and crime investigations will have access to that data.
Basically, in China, it's not the World Wide Web, and if you want to own any sort of website in China, you have to store all of your data in the country. Which not only makes it incredibly hard to sell people's data internationally, which is actually probably a good thing if you're one of the vast majority of people who doesn't own social media companies, but it also opens up your secure intellectual property to the Chinese government, who just want to see how Google works under the hood to tweak their own state-owned competitor. American officials have criticized these new regulations, claiming it's making it too hard for firms like Google, Apple, and Amazon to secure their share of the world internet. Which, wow, never thought I'd hear people complaining about how, you know who really needs more exposure on the internet? Google and Amazon. That's like wishing the news would just dedicate a little more time to covering the latest official who's talking about our president's incompetency. So those are the sticking points in talks between the US and China right now. Until next time, that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking this floating logo to the right of my head. or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. And ring that bell to make sure that freedom will continue to ring. Remember to give me a thumbs up. And, as always, thank you for watching.